Hello, welcome to my kitchen. My name is Andrew. In this video, you're gonna see me cook a lot of onions. So if that's not what you're interested in, I'm sorry. Recently on the channel, I made a video where I cooked 25 pounds of potatoes. And the long story short is that I had all these leftover potatoes from yet another video. I took the opportunity to make a bunch of potato recipes that I had never made before. And it was a very enjoyable experience. It's kind of like you can take the same walk multiple times and notice something new and different each time. But I was doing that with potatoes. I wanted to do it again, and this time I'm doing onions. And onions are a very magical ingredient. In their raw form, they're useful, but they're not obviously delicious. But through cooking, they can really transform and become sweet and take on other flavors. So like with the potato video, I went to the wholesale produce area of Los Angeles. Most of the quantities available were 50-pound bags, but one vendor offered to sell me a partial bag, which ended up being a little less than 20 pounds. And I also divided the recipes into three general techniques: caramelizing, pickling, and frying. So I've made all of these dishes, and now I'm gonna take you through how it went. The first recipe I did was French onion soup, and I followed Julie Child's recipe, and you can actually find her old cooking shows online, Julia Child Cooking Classics. So you begin by slicing a bunch of onions. I ended up cutting about 5 or 6. The other good thing about this video is that it's great practice for cutting onions. So you're slicing them into thin slices, and then in a large pot with butter and oil, begin caramelizing them. And really you're just avoiding scorching the bottom, continuously stirring from time to time, and it takes you a good long while to really develop the deep caramelized color. Occasionally, if the pot is becoming a little hot and you get some sticky onion that is threatening to burn, just add a little bit of water to loosen that up. And this also kind of releases all of these sugars that have begun to caramelize and redistributes them evenly throughout this pot of onions so that you're slowly developing towards this even brownness everywhere. So while those are cooking, you also need to create this toasted bread for the top, these croûtes. This is just slicing a baguette, drizzling it with a little oil, and then putting it into the oven until it just dries out. So once the onions are in a good state, you add some flour and stir that to cook for a moment. And I added wine, some stock, and some water. Then it simmers for a while. At this point, the soup is essentially done. You have something that you can eat. But the way that it's usually served is with this caramelized cheese on top. Then you spoon over the soup, a touch of cognac to the top. And this is there just for flavor. Put more croûtes on the top, more cheese, and then it goes into the oven for about 20 minutes. I ended up switching on the broiler to really ensure that the top of the cheese got very nice and melty. It's very interesting that this recipe doesn't even have herbs in it. You're really just eating the flavor of onion, which is very delicious. This feels like a preparation that came to prominence before people realized that you can eat a sandwich on the side of soup, which I think is how I would prefer to serve it in the future. So making a grilled cheese with that Gruyere and having a little teacup of this onion broth on the side. The next dish I made was chicken yassa, which is a Senegalese dish. And I referenced the recipe from Chef Pierre Thiem's The Fonio Cookbook. So this dish begins the day before with a marinade of scallions, thyme, lime juice, vinegar, oil, and you mix that with whole chicken legs. And I let that marinate overnight. So the next day, we begin slicing a bunch of onions. I slice them a little bit thicker than what I had done for the French onion soup. And you begin caramelizing these in a pot. And the recipe specifies leaving the onions to sit for a moment in the pot before stirring them so that they develop color just on this one side. So once they developed a little bit of that color on the bottom, I stir them up and continued caramelizing them as normal. You then add Dijon mustard, habanero, a bay leaf, and also adding a touch of water to make sure that the mixture isn't sticking and burning to the bottom of the pot. So the next step was grilling the chicken, which I thought was very interesting in a dish that is going to be finished as a braise together. But it's so cool that you're gonna take this charcoal grill flavor and then infuse that into this saucy, braisey situation. So then the chicken is added to the pot, you then season with lime juice. I then also made this pepper paste of chilies, bell pepper, bay leaf, garlic, and ginger. And you add just a couple of tablespoons of that to the pot. At this point, I just added some water as needed and let it simmer for a while. And then when that was finished, you add some green olives. And that's the dish. This was extremely delicious. Caramelized onions can become so sweet to the point of being kind of cloying. But with this dish, you have all of these contrasting flavors. There's the lime juice, there's the bitterness and smoke that comes from barbecuing. You have these briny bites of the olives, and then this flavor of mustard is there. I know that we're pretty early in the video, but this was my favorite thing I made for the whole video. It was so good. Moving on to the pickles. The next dish I tried is called Yangpa Changaji, which is a Korean pickled onion. And this recipe I actually got from my friend Yoon, who's been on the show Worth It before. She's the very talented chef from Spoon by H. So first I cut my onion to sort of a large dice. I don't know what you call this, a large square. And I put that in a large jar. I think I did 2 onions total. And I also diced a single green chili, which is optional for some spice. So next you're simply boiling together a brine of soy sauce, water, sugar, mirin, and salt, as well as some dried kelp. The brine boils together, then you shut the heat off. After a couple of minutes, you add vinegar and lemon. And then after a couple of minutes, you pour this over the onions, trying not to make a giant mess, but look, sometimes. So at this point, the onions can sit at room temperature for a day or two, and then in the refrigerator after that. And that's it. Then you have a big jar of flavored onions at your disposal at any time. And this is in fact meant to be eaten as a side dish alongside meat or like with a savory pancake. And these were so good. They're so flavorful. Yoon also gave me a tip to save this liquid for future marinades and things like that. So the next thing I made was a Belizean onion and habanero sauce. This is also something that I had for the first time in a Worth It episode. And we went to this food truck, Saraba Garifuna Cuisine, where we had these amazing fried panades. And the condiment was this onion habanero sauce. And it was so delicious and really surprising at the time. So I actually contacted Winston from Saraba and he helped me out with the recipe. So to start, you wanna clean and soak onions in cold water briefly before drying them off and essentially mincing the onion. You wanted to get it to a very fine cube. You also mince 1 habanero pepper. You also add some allspice berries, which are there not to be eaten, but just to impart their flavor. And then you make the brine, which is simply water and vinegar that you boil together. And then you pour that over the onion and habanero, and that's it. This is a deceptively simple combination of things. And Winston told me that you could eat this on pretty much anything. I enjoyed it over some fish that I made. I know it seems like you're just eating a mouthful of raw onion, but the flavor is really pretty great. Habanero is one of my favorite chili flavors. Not because it's so spicy, but because it has like this really floral taste to it. The sharpness of the onion is softened a little bit, and then this perfume of the habanero gets imparted throughout this whole thing. But it's amazing just how flavorful just a few simple ingredients can get when allowed to sit together for a bit. So next I made the fried onion recipes. And the first one I did is the bloomin' onion. The onion that is fried to resemble a blooming flower. And I referenced a recipe from the Food Network. And so you start by cutting the stem end off, put that cut side down, making even incisions around the onion all the way down, and then between those cuts until you have a bloomed onion. Then you have a seasoned flour mixture that just has some cayenne, paprika, cumin, this sort of thing. And you set the onion inside and they tell you to put some sort of covering on top and then shake it around so that this flour mixture gets incorporated in all of the little crevices of the onion. Then in a separate bowl where you have some eggs, milk, and water beat together, dunk it in that. It goes back to the flour where it's now sort of all caked up in batter. And then basically you fry it. So the first time I made it, I messed up. I think I did not separate the petals enough. So I ended up with these just sort of large chunks of fried battered onion. So I did it again. This time I made more incisions. And also when going to fry it, I realized that the instructions said actually put it cut side first into the oil. I think this forces the petals apart a little bit. Then after a couple of minutes, you flip it over and then it fries for a total of 6 or 8 minutes. And that's it. You have this incredible looking fried onion. If I had never heard of a bloomin' onion before and I saw it on a plate, I would think that it came from the fanciest restaurant in the world. It is also extremely delicious. It's very fun to eat. You pick these petals apart. I made a little sort of dairy dipping situation. It is so good. I thought I was gonna hate making a bloomin' onion and I was just doing it for the fun of saying that I did it, but damn, this thing is good. I basically ate an entire fried onion by myself and I was not mad about it for one single moment. So the last dish I made is onion bhaji, which are an Indian onion fritter. And I referenced a recipe from Madhur Jaffrey's Quick and Easy Indian Cooking. So with these fritters, you begin by making a batter. You whisk one egg in a bowl, add some water and lemon juice. Then you incorporate chickpea flour, cayenne pepper, garam masala, cumin seeds, ground cumin, turmeric. You then also incorporate green chili and cilantro. I was a little unsure of the consistency, so I ended up adding back a little bit more flour. I thought that this was ultimately something that I would have to figure out by feel. I took a couple onions, sliced them, and then mixed those into the batter immediately before frying. Because I think if you allowed it to sit together, the onions would leach out moisture and change the consistency of the mix. So I got my oil hot, I formed them into medium-ish balls and dropped them in. I think ultimately I formed them a little bit too large perhaps, but I just took care to continuously flip them and move them around for 6 or 7 minutes until they seemed very thoroughly fried. And wow, this very interesting consistency on the outside of like the craggly onion that sticks out. And I also think it's really great that there's both cumin powder to flavor the batter, but then you also have these cumin seeds that occasionally you'll get a bite of one and you get like this pop of cumin. I really don't think I nailed these. My batter was perhaps too thick and there was too much of it. I think this is really a recipe that rewards repeat making because you'll develop the sort of reference point of what you're looking for in the final consistency that you're frying. But overall, they tasted so, so good. So that's how I cooked 20 pounds of onions. Onions, probably the best vegetable. There, I said it. Well, if you have any suggestions on other ingredients that I should make a bunch of recipes from a large amount of, please let me know. But until then, thanks for watching. Probably would be the Iron Man of the Vegetable Avengers.